A couple episodes ago, I got this request. Please don't use AI images. It's so disheartening to see channels that purport to care about the environment and humans using AI images. So should Edenicity use AI? If you're new to the channel, welcome to Edenicity, Best Practices for Sustainably Abundant Cities. Edenicity is a combination of permaculture and urbanism, permaculture being a system of ecological home and farm design with about 1 million certified designers worldwide. And urbanism is the human-centered design of a city's large-scale systems, such as energy, transportation, housing, water, sanitation, recreation, and services. So yes, as you'll see throughout this episode, this is a channel about cities and the environment. So it seemed a really valid question. Now, the first thing I did as a designer was go and research the topic, and I had some numbers and was ready to post a quick reply. And then I realized, no, you know what? The better thing to do with design is to make sure I understand what's being asked. So I wrote back and said, other than AI appearing in the video as a potential threat, what is your specific environmental objection? Now, because I did narrow the scope of the discussion to environmental threats, let me just point out that a number of experts in the AI field, as well as famous personalities such as Elon Musk, have spoken out about the dangers of AI getting out of control and harming human beings. In my view, and backed by the evidence I'll present later, this is a really large-scale discussion to be held at the highest possible levels of policymaking. But anyway, I wanted to be sure I understood what the environmental objections were, because that might be something that we could address in Edenicity. Someone else jumped in, pointing out that their concerns were energy and water use. They couldn't quite remember the numbers or their sources, but off the top of their head provided some numbers and the sense that this is a field that is getting out of control and is becoming very menacing. Good. We have a good starting point. People have some perceptions, some numbers, and I've actually got some sources, and Edenicity sets a clear standard for what we should be trying to achieve with the environment. Let's go. Edenicity's performance standard is to meet our needs something like 20 times better on something like 95% less land. Obviously, this is aspirational. And just to give you a sense of how extreme this is, the Edenicity criterion is 10 times more severe than the half-Earth proposal by E.O. Wilson that was widely seen as way too radical. So against that performance expectation, let's look at the AI numbers. I found this article and pulled some numbers from it, put them in a spreadsheet, and then pulled some more numbers from this article here. And the bottom line is that 1,000 generative AI images is about as much energy as it takes to drive a gas-burning car 4.1 miles, or 6.6 kilometers. For my Earth backup episode, I generated about 240 AI images, which works out to about 1.6 kilometers of travel using a gas-powered car. I also looked up the figures for streaming video at full high-definition resolution, which result for the carbon dioxide produced, and then looked at standard definition, which would be a much lower figure for carbon production. I also looked up the total data use of Edenicity, and in this format that you see here, with me in a tiny circle and the relatively static slides, Edenicity uses about 45% less energy than if I were using the full screen the whole time. So 1 hour of Edenicity videos works out to 1.1 kilometers of driving. And you actually have the power to cut that down significantly. If you were to watch Edenicity upright on your phone at 480p resolution, then watching an hour of Edenicity would be like driving just 52 meters, half the length of a football field. 1 kilometer, 52 meters, is that good or bad? Well, when you compare it to the average weekly mileage of a car in the United States, we find that both answers are hundreds of times less than the weekly mileage. So if it takes me a week or so to put together one of these videos and I'm not doing a lot of driving during that time, I'm way, way, way ahead of the game by factors of hundreds than I would be if I was out running errands and getting footage. Let's look at water. 1,000 AI images uses about 2 liters of water, according to the papers I just showed you. So that means that the Earth backup episode works out to about half a liter of water, which is about this much water. Cheers. And if you watch it in 480p mode, it works out to 16 milliliters, or just over 1 tablespoon of water. Now, is that a lot? Well, let's compare it to some things. The U.S. Geological Survey published a brief summary of how much water is used to produce various food items that you might enjoy every day, including bread, chicken, coffee, corn, eggs, and hamburger. Let's zoom in on that hamburger. To produce a quarter pound of U.S. beef requires 1,700 liters of water, or 3,400 of these glasses. An hour of Edenicity videos is roughly 1/3 of a liter. And again, if you watch it at 480p, you can get that down to to just over a tablespoon. So as you can see, many of our other daily lifestyle decisions have much bigger consequences than using AI. But the discussion was far from over. Another commenter pointed out that Google has missed its climate goal this year because of the massive astronomical amount of energy it's taking to fuel its new AI-assisted search results. This article from the AP discusses the water impacts of the data centers that build the large language models of artificial intelligence. The alarming numbers are that Google reported a 20% growth in water use at the same time that Microsoft reported a 34% spike from 2021 to 2022. And it goes on to explain just how the water use works with the data centers. Basically, in the data centers in this article, when the temperatures got over 29.3 degrees Celsius, about 85 Fahrenheit, they needed to draw water to cool down the data centers. And this amounted to about 6% of the water used in the district during that time. Not immediately threatening, but given that this is a growing industry, there were many valid questions raised about where this was going in the future. Now, from my perspective, there's a lot of design work that can be done to improve the situation. In particular, where there's large-scale heating and cooling, there's the potential for long-term geothermal storage and district-level heat exchange, meaning that they could cycle the water into the ground and warm up an underground thermal battery. Then the township could draw from that for heating in winter. This is actually done very efficiently in many parts of the world, but if they're going to do it, it needs to be designed in from the beginning, or there's seldom any hope of it being cost efficient. But one other thing that caught my eye in this story, and this was a really pleasant surprise, was that Microsoft was attracted to the city's commitment to building public infrastructure and contributed a staggering sum of money through tax payments to support their investment. This is really different from the usual narrative these days for small cities in America. A lot of small cities compete to try to attract big employers with tax abatements, but the town of West Des Moines, Iowa, did the reverse. In fact, no grants or tax abatements were provided for the project, but Microsoft has added $2 billion to the local property tax base as of this year. And all I can say is, way to go, West Des Moines. I've been harping on this issue for years on this channel, that we need to stop the race to the bottom with tax abatements and tax breaks and start building towns that compete on amenities, build a great place to live, and that's where workers want to be, and that's where companies will be forced to follow. A commenter also helpfully pointed out that there are other browsers, such as Ecosia, that are actually carbon negative, meaning that they take enough of their advertising money and spend it on carbon sequestering activities, such as tree planting, to more than offset the cost of the data centers on which they run their search services. That's when the original commenter pointed out that even the Ecosia browser has an AI function, but at least you can turn it off, unlike in Google. All right, this was all really good news. It was great to learn. And I love the fact that there are choices out there. But you know what? As somebody who's been a bit of a lifestyle activist for many decades now, one of the reasons I founded Edenicity was because of the lack of choice that many of us have in our daily lives. In the US, and unfortunately in much of the world today, you can't function without a car. You can't live in places that are good for the environment. You can't eat without participating in agriculture that is highly destructive, as we'll see in a moment. Because the large-scale design of the systems that keep us alive often does not include any environmentally sound choices. And this lack of choice is really apparent when it comes to your use of AI. Because let's face it, you are using AI right now. The YouTube feed that brought you this video did that with an AI algorithm. The voice-to-text, which you see in the closed captions, used AI. And if the captions aren't complete garbage, it's because the video creator took the time to separately transcribe them, probably using two steps of AI. When you're texting people, those autocomplete suggestions are AI-driven. Your phone maps that provide planned or real-time routes and public transit options are driven by AI. And by the way, this has happened to me several times. I've been waiting for a bus and somebody approaches me and says, hey, do you know which bus I can take to such and such a place? And I say, well, hey, have you got a phone? And I direct them to their map app, just tap in their destination, get directions, choose public transit, and in real time, in many parts of the world, you get up-to-the-minute scheduling, alternative options, and route planning to arrive at your destination whenever you want in the future. There's the ubiquitous voice assistants, spam filters, photo tagging, and my favorite, visual lookup. I was out walking the other day and I smelled just wonderful aroma. I'm like, what is that? And I found this flower. I said, you know, I'm not familiar with this, but I'll bet it's gardenia. Took a picture, tapped the little eye, and it turned out to be Tahitian gardenia. Just wonderful stuff. AI again. You can see that it is really hard to separate ourselves and become lifestyle activists boycotting AI when we are so entwined with it, even right now as I speak. And it's moments like this, when we're really far down that rabbit hole, that I turn my focus back to the biggest problems at hand. And for me, the biggest problem is land use. We currently use more than half the land on Earth, and we've wiped out more than half the life on Earth. In this image, you can see that there's a few stands of trees and then giant fields planted in single crops. A lot has been written about the vast scale of these fields horizontally, but I'm much more concerned with the vertical arrangement in this picture. In that tiny stand of tree, there's ground covers, shrubs, trees, and probably a vine layer, and innumerable animals of multiple species in each of these layers. In these fields, by contrast, the farmers are doing everything they can to make sure that there is one and only one living being at most between earth and sky. And this is the mechanism by which we have killed more than half the living biomass of the planet. Can you see that this is a problem that is way bigger than anything that virtue signaling and boycotts could solve? Believe me, I've tried. For about a decade, I boycotted things like gas mowers, thinking that if I created a really great landscape, that other people would be inspired to follow suit. And as near as I can tell, absolutely zero minds were changed in the process. When I looked around and visited eco-villages throughout Tennessee, Indiana, and Ohio, I saw that regardless of the health of the communities, they were not changing the behavior of those around them. Why is this? Again, it's because the big problems in the world are problems of large-scale design. In his book, Dirt, The Erosion of Civilizations, David R. Montgomery pointed out that layered gardens since antiquity have yielded 10, and in some cases up to 100 times more calories and nutrition per hectare than plantations. By the way, I've put a link to that book in the description and eventually in the comments. And while you're there, if you're finding this illuminating, be sure to leave a like, and if you see a little subscribe button, be sure to tap that so that we can connect again in the future. What permaculturists have made of this fact that Charles Montgomery has pointed out is that we should all become farmers and gardeners and tend our own gardens. The problem with that, and believe me, I tried for about a decade, is that it's a ticket to poverty for the vast majority of people that try. Cities house 57% of the world's population on just 3% of the land area. Remarkably, as I've pointed out in many episodes, most of the area in cities is dedicated to cars, somewhere between 50% and up to 80% when you consider parking spaces, streets, green strips, and setbacks. Most of that space is devoted to cars. So to restore the lost half of life on Earth, the Edenicity proposal is to upgrade cities to produce their own energy and food. This is, of course, very utopian, and people get a bit nervous about that, thinking, well, hey, one person's utopia, it could be another person's dystopia. But Edenicity is meant to compete in a world where people have choices. Edenized cities will compete well for talent, because at core, these are mixed-use, transit-oriented garden low-rise developments, which offer a much more serene, convenient, walkable, affordable way of life with 75% less utility costs. They're also car-free, which makes them 20 times safer and many times healthier, with 75% less noise and 90% lower transportation costs. Now, the end game of all this is that every square kilometer of a city that's Edenized unburdens 10 to 20 square kilometers of land for restoration. This is the mechanism by which we can restore the lost half of life on Earth. One of my core design principles is that design embodies intention. Some tools embody hostile intentions, and others are more general purpose, so they can be used for both destruction or creation. When I took my first permaculture course in the US in the early 2000s, it was taught with a really anti-technology perspective, in part because a lot of permaculture design is built in places that are facing desperate poverty and don't have access to expensive tools. But when I took my second permaculture course with Jeff Lawton out of Australia, the emphasis was entirely different. Instead of small hand tools, they focused on large earth-moving machines, with the idea that burning a little bit of gasoline for one day would pay for itself in a landscape that is reshaped to provide water and restore soil fertility for generations to come. One of Lawton's messages that I finally got loud and clear is not to hate the tools, but to understand your own intentions, seek the most positive intentions you can for yourself, the environment, and generations yet to come, and then find the tools that are best suited to that. AI is one of these general purpose tools. I've already used it, of course, for images on this channel, but I've also used it to do things like code up the Edenicity quiz. That's the place on the Edenicity website, I put a link in the description, where you can answer a few questions and determine subjectively the Edenicity score of where you live, and then compare it to other scores on the Edenicity world map. Here's how that worked. I asked ChatGPT to write some JavaScript code for me that would create a quiz based on these criteria, and it immediately basically outputted a quiz, which actually ran first time, but it was really bad code. Very inflexible, very hard to fix. If you know your way around code, you know that this wouldn't cut it. It would be very difficult in the long run to maintain. So I said, hey, could you factor those drop-down questions into a separate function? That'll make it a lot easier to update the quiz in the future. And it did so, and I tested it. It looked good. I got off onto another project for a moment and then came back to it and said, hey, could you recast range sliders? The first way I had it, it just had numbers that you pulled down. It did that. And then I asked ChatGPT if it could improve the user experience by moving some of the elements around on the page. And it did that. But then I said, well, there's a couple of problems. It turned out that as you interacted with it and made different choices, the page elements would jump around. And that was very difficult to look at. So it fixed that. And each of these interactions is maybe 5 or 10 minutes of me testing and then getting back to ChatGPT. And then I asked it to make the sliders twice as big. You know, I was pretty rusty at this point. It had been a long time since I coded. Did that and even schooled me a little bit in how to do that on my own in the future. So the end result was that I was able to create this interactive page in well under an hour, which would be no big deal for an experienced coder. But since it's been a long time for me, I think it would have taken me probably about 20 hours to get back up to speed and do it on my own. And that's maybe being a little bit optimistic, but it really does help to have coding experience, because otherwise I would have had no idea that the initial code that it wrote me was terrible, and I would have had no idea what kind of user experience was possible. It's always a good idea to consider your intentions and the costs of using the tools and comparing those to other choices that are available to you, and to support efforts that give us more choices in the direction of having a long, abundant future on this planet. Anyway, I've actually got 13 AI projects in the queue for Edenicity. And I think it's safe to say that each of these will end up saving many times more energy and other resources than they use. I probably won't get to all of them, but I really am excited to share the ones that work out with you in the future. Thanks as always to my wonderful patrons for financially supporting this channel. It means the world to me. And if you have a moment, check out one of these videos here. Take care, stay green, see you next time.